you so much for braving this bitter cold, but I have a praise report. It's going to be 27 degrees today. Amen. It's sad when I'm so excited that it's going to be 27 degrees. Let's put our hands together and get ready to give him praise, for he has given us every reason to sing out to him. Come.
You have given me a reason, so I'm singing my praise unto you. You have lifted every burden, so I'm singing my praise unto you. It's a brand new day.
It's a brand new day.
So I'll give you praise.
Give you praise. It's all for you, Lord, it's all for you. You're the reason that I lift my voice and give you praise. Lord, I give you praise for the things you do. Cause there's nobody like you, you, you. There's nobody like you, you, you. There's nobody like you.
You got me singing and rejoicing, overflowing with praise unto you. Now I'm living in your freedom, overflowing with praise unto you. It's a brand
I'll give you praise.
will stand. And I will call upon your name. Lift my eyes above the waves. When ocean rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours. Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now. And I will call.
Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
In the presence of my Savior.
let's just stay in this realm of worship. Aren't you glad that we worship a Savior who calls you his child, who is the only one who can make a way when there seems to be no way? Every mountain and every obstacle that seems impossible to us is everything. It's possible with God. So God, we just pray right now that for those of us with any doubt, for those of us with any heartache, for those of us, God, that are searching for answers, God, I pray right now that your presence would come into this place and that we would remember that you are the way maker. You're the miracle worker, God. You keep your promises, and all just because that's who you are. God, there are so many things that we could say to describe you, but never is it enough. There aren't enough words, Jesus. So we'll sing our praise to you today.
You are here. Oh, you're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you.
Yeah.
that again.
Waymaker, miracle worker. Waymaker, miracle worker.
Way come on, maker, some of you need to feel that this morning, worker, that He is your waymaker. That He is your miracle worker.
Waymaker.
So from our hearts,
worker,
let's cry that out to Him.
Waymaker.
God, you are the waymaker.
Waymaker.
Come on, sing it again.
Miracle worker. Waymaker, miracle worker. Waymaker, miracle worker. Waymaker, miracle worker. Waymaker, miracle worker.
Sometimes when we get into these habits of just living every single day to day to day, we forget. We forget the miracle that took place on that cross over 2,000 years ago. We forget that although it seems like it's impossible to us, and no matter how hard we try, we just can't break through. We forget that we serve a God that's a waymaker. We serve a God that works miracles. We serve a God that shines light into dark places. And even though sometimes we can't see it, and even though sometimes we can't feel it, He never, ever, ever stops working. So if you believe that, if you believe that you serve a God that never, ever, ever stops working on your behalf, just close your eyes and lift your hands to the Waymaker as we sing this out. Oh, Jesus.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. And even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. And even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. And even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. And even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never
come
stop.
On, all of that. Even when I can't
working.
See it, God, you're working.
Even when I can't see it, you're working.
Even when I can't feel it, my God is working.
Feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop working. And even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. That is who you are.
If you believe that, put those hands together. Come on, if you really, really believe that God is making a way, I said, if you really believe that God is making a way, take the next 30 seconds and send your praise in advance for what you are believing God to do. Come on, for the next 30 seconds, send up a praise.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. And even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Come on, let's start this new year with a praise. Come on. He's worthy. He's worthy. You know, this is kind of an Easter twist to it, but when they were going to anoint Jesus' body, they said, there's just one problem. They said, there's a stone rolled in front of the tomb, and we can't move it. But to their surprise, when they got there, the stone had been rolled away. Stones represent hindrances, obstacles, circumstances that are blocking you from your promise and seeing the promise of God in your life. And somebody in this room needs to know right now, God supernaturally is going to remove the stones from your life, and you are going to see the promise of God. Come on, if you really believe that, then give him praise like you believe it. As a matter of fact, just nudge your neighbor and tell him, you're going to see it. You're going to see it. Come on. You're going to see it. Do me a favor. Before you're seated, just turn around and tell two or three people that they are looking really good today. Would you do that right now? How many are enjoying the weather? Hey, you know what? Not a fair question. On my way in this morning, when we were driving, I remembered something I said along, I think it was October. Remember when it was unseasonably warm in October? And I stood up here because the air conditioner hardly works here. And I stood up here and I said, I will be so glad when this warm weather goes away. How many of you know you need to be really careful what you say? Amen. I will be so happy when warm weather comes back. Anybody else in agreement with me this morning? We're on the rise. It's supposed to warm up a little bit this afternoon. But anyway, you're here. It's Northern Ohio. We're used to it. We're tough, right? That was your chance to pat yourself on the chest. You're tough. Amen. So good to have each and every one of you here this morning. I'm going to receive this morning's offering. But before I do that, I want to share a few things with you. And kind of wanted to do this before, actually last weekend, but due to the weather and everything, I just held off on it. But I just want to give God all the praise and all the glory on just a great 2017. Amen? Just a great 2017. Someone say, well, my 2017 wasn't too hot. You're still alive. You're still breathing. You have your right mind, I think. But anyhow, God's been good to us. Amen? And so there are a few things I just want to go back through and highlight as we get ready to receive, just to kind of show you the impact that you have on your giving. This was our Easter service. Look at Hot Rod there dancing as he always does. And on Easter Sunday, we had over 600 people in attendance. So can we give God all the praise and all the glory? Man, look at that weather. Let's hide some eggs out there today. But so that was our Easter service, and so many people helped make that just a very, very special day. And then one of our outreach ministries we did was Osborne Park, and we were able to go to Osborne Park, and our praise team was there, some drama team, and our cardboard testimony, and we were able to minister to many people through our outreach ministry team. And God blessed us, and we saw three or four or five people give their hearts to Jesus. We gave an open invitation right there in the park, and one of the families that was a part of this was Jessica and her family. Right here she is. Right here's the family. Jessica, just kind of, there she is. They've been coming ever since this day. Not only coming, but they are involved in ministry. They help and they serve. They serve our children and they serve a setup and takedown and all of those things, any special events that we've had. So I just want you to see that it does make a difference. Someone's life, someone's family was changed. And we give God all the glory. And then we had our VBS over the summer with all of our kids and just enjoying these pictures. And that's our course of the VBS Sunday that we had. Just a great, great group of kids and just an awesome, awesome team that serves our children. Would you let them know you appreciate them as well? It was VBS. And then partnering with Amber and Hope Over Heroin, we were able to just send some people out and to help, just to be there, to be a support and to let our community know that every life matters. We care. We want to help in any way that we can, support in any way that we can. And Amber has all the numbers for all of these things that took place. What a great, great weekend. People understand and realize that there is hope. It doesn't have to end in devastation and despair. So once again, Amber and your team and all of you that helped with that, God bless you. Thank you for that. Then our Sunday fun day, this is with our children. And again, we want to make sure that we are ministering to the next generation. And so we have, there's Tommy making some ribs. That looks good right now. Amen. But just all the people that helped make these events so special, and just a special day for us. There were over 70 kids that were ministered to as far as like receiving school supplies and those types of things to send them back to school. So one more time, let's give them a hand for their service as well. And then Stuff the Bus, where you brought your scarves and your gloves and your boots, and you guys are looking for pictures. It's not going to be there. We had our GoPro going at that time. We were videotaping people stuffing the bus. But let me tell you what they shared with me. Typically, they're at a place for 4 hours. And in that four-hour period, they get, you know, people donating. But what they said was they received more in 1 hour than they typically do in 4 hours from this group right here as you ministered and helped those. So you have to understand, somebody's wearing a coat today, someone has a hat on today, someone has a pair of boots on today, because you helped them, you supported them, you gave, and so we give God all the praise for that. And then recently we were at Hannah's house for a Christmas dinner. I'm not sure that we have a picture, that's not Hannah's house, but I'll talk about that in a moment, but I think the outreach team again. Tammy was a part of that. Tammy, are you in here somewhere? I know she was teaching Growth Track this morning. Several of the all the ladies that were part of the growth or the Hannah's House blessing, would you just lift up your hand so we can recognize you right now? Over here, back here, right here. Amen. Christmas dinner. And then we asked you to help with a couple of families, to be able to bless a couple of families at Christmas time this year. There were two families we also partnered with. Help me out, Kristen. What is it? Family Chiropractic that provided gifts as well for two families within our church. And we just wanted to make their Christmas a little bit brighter. And so we were able to do that through your contributions and your gifts. Family Chiropractic, amen. That's in Painesville. So if you need a good crack in the back, you can go see them, which I do. But anyhow, we'll make arrangements for that. And also, that was the two families that we adopted and blessed during Christmas. And then not probably, but the most important numbers were we had 80 salvations, 37 water baptisms this past year. Can we just take a minute and give God all the praise and give God all the glory? God is so awesome. God is so awesome. Some of our baptism pictures. By the way, I think we are doing baptism, God bless you, at the end of the month. So if you've not been baptized, they're probably going to talk about that in the announcement. But if you need to be water baptized, we want you to sign up for that as well. Ushers, if you'll come. Last week I said I was going to hold off in sharing something with you. So I want to share that with you as well this week. Of course, many of you know that we are pursuing property at Shamrock Center. They're in Painesville, right over by the Diamond Center. And we're still in the process. We need you to be praying about that. Some things I'll be sharing with you as we move on. But we're raising money, and we're wanting to secure that piece of property. Just want you to know how God works. When we do our part, God does his part. All right? There was a sermon I preached a while back, and it's called Dig a Ditch. And when they dug the ditch, God provided the water. What does that mean? It simply means this. You do what you can do, and God will do what only he can do. Okay? And so we're doing all that we know to do. We thank God for this. We thank God for this place that we can assemble. But we're believing God has a permanent home for us. Amen? We believe that with all of our heart, and we're moving towards that. Well, right before Christmas, we received from an anonymous donor, that said, I want this just to be designated specifically to the building fund. I don't know where it came from. I don't know who sent it. I've tried to figure it out, but I've quit doing that. But we received a check of $20,000. How many of you know God can do it? $20,000. I have no clue where it came from. They don't want to know. They don't want me to know. We called. You know, Marisa said, is this real? She called, and they said, that's a real check. You better go cash it. And so it is in our building fund account. I'll be sharing some financial numbers with you as I talk more about our building fund. I just want you to know that we're not just assembling on Sunday morning. We are making a difference. And how many of you know the best is yet to come? The best is yet to come. Let's pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity to give. I thank you, Lord, that you laid it upon the heart of a group or an individual to sow into this church. I thank you, Lord, for all the ministries, all the people that we have been able to reach by your people's willingness to sacrifice and to give and to support this ministry. We thank you for 2017, but we are believing 2018 is going to be the greatest year ever at Life Point Church. Salvations, baptisms, restorations, healings, deliverance, all part of your plan. We give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And everyone said, amen. Go ahead, ushers.
Good morning, LifePoint Church.
Good morning, everybody. How's it going? It's good to see everybody.
Is everybody warmed up?
Warm here. Hey, fun fact, Thursday is supposed to be 50 degrees. Woo-hoo! It's going to be a warm-up. So let's get all excited about that. Absolutely. So thank you so much for joining us today. If this is your first time, absolutely very happy to have you and very honored that you've chosen to come and worship with us today. We do have a gift for you. We don't want you to leave empty-handed. So please stop by LifePoint Central on your way out. And we'd like to do that as well. Also want to give a big shout out and a huge welcome to everybody that is joining us online today. I'm actually logged in right now. We have a few dozen people watching us right now.
Yes, that's awesome.
Just to kind of shout out Pam, Grandma Pat's on there. We got Debbie, Linda, Jenny Sturgill, and Tony and family. Thank you guys so much for
Jenny's
joining
two
in.
Two places at once.
Yeah, I know, absolutely. Look at that. Oh, there you are. I didn't even know you were in here. Hey, how's it going? So if you're on there, again, thank you for joining us in your warm and cozy homes. Matter of fact, we have somebody from California watching us right now.
Awesome.
We don't know who that is, but thank you for tuning in all the way across the country. And just give us a little shout out. Let us know that you're out there, and we'd love to connect with you.
Absolutely. Today is our first official Sunday of 2018, and it's also the first day of our fast. Who's excited?
Who binged on bad food last night?
Oh, you know what? I ate so bad. I won't tell you how many donuts I had this weekend. But anyway, today is our fast. And you know, we recommend or suggest that you do the Daniel fast. There with your insert is some guidelines. If you can't do the Daniel fast, you know, we just encourage you to fast in some way. Maybe it's you're going to fast TV for 21 days or the radio. Do people still listen to the radio? I don't know. But your cell phone, Morgan still listens. Oh, we can't fast the radio because we have to listen to Morgan. Anyway, we encourage you to join us on this church-wide fast in whichever way suits you. But it's a really good time for you to not only do some spiritual soul searching, but as a church, we can come together and we can see a lot of good things happen. And, you know, I personally think that I'm going to be focusing on this building that's coming up. So it's a, you know, you may have something else you want to focus on, but please get involved in the fast as well as the Bible reading. Who's current? Anybody current on their Bible? Oh, you guys are doing good. If you haven't had a chance to download the app, YouVersion, it's so simple. You go to bible.com/app. There's a link on lpcmentor.com. Takes you right to it. It walks you through it throughout your day. You know, you can maybe break it up. But we just encourage you to keep doing that with us too, because it's a great habit to get into.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
No, it absolutely is. Along lines with that, with the website, we are really excited because life groups will be starting up next month again. Who's been a part of a life group in the house here? Let's see the hands.
I miss my life group. I'm ready for it.
I know. We get withdrawals when we're not with our groups there. That's pretty awesome. Yeah. So if you want some more information about that, again, you can check out out front before you leave. Obviously, on our website, we're going to have some information as well. But we're also looking for more life group leaders. If you have just that leadership quality in you, if you've always wanted to be with a group of people and lead them in some way, if you have a topic within the group that we're lacking maybe that you'd like to bring up, we'd love to have you. I'd love to hear more about that as well. So on the website, again, what is that?
lpcmentor.com.
Just like you saying that, it sounds
Thank
good
you.
For some reason. You can connect with us under the Connect tab, and there'll be some information about the groups, and then there's also a Life Group Leader application underneath that as well. So fill that out, and we'll get that to the appropriate people here, and we'll connect with you on that as well.
Awesome. Pastor spoke about baptism. We do have a baptism on the calendar for January 28th. We're going to do it right out in the parking lot.
Not Lake Erie?
Come on. Actually, we'll do it right here on stage, which is so cool. If you've experienced a baptism at Life Point Church, I don't know, I just love those services because we worship, people are getting baptized, lives are changed. It's so exciting. So if you've not had the opportunity to be baptized, you can go to lpcmentor.com and sign up. You can stop and talk to the ladies at Life Point Central and get signed up. However you got to do it, just let's get it done.
It's pretty exciting.
It is.
It's a good.
We want to have the most yet, so.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Good.
28th. Don't forget it.
Who has, like, at least one app on their phone? Just one. I hope everybody like raises their hand. That's okay. So we're really excited because we, LifePoint Central, or LifePoint Church, I'm sorry, we have an app now, okay? And we want to make sure that you guys get that in your hands as well. So we're going to get some information pulled up here. This is a really great way for us to get some information to you. There it goes again. Does it mean I have to stop talking now?
I don't know. Just go.
It's a great way. You're going to have a lot of resources on it. We'll be able to connect with you, push notifications when things are happening. So instead of getting like the annoying, you know, Marisa liked your photo on Facebook, you might be able to, you know, we'll provide that information for you.
Can
as well.
You like tell us when to get to church and what time to get there?
We can. Okay. We can do that. Absolutely. So if you go to our website,
lpcmentor.com,
whether it's on your phone or on the computer, we have a couple of badges down here now. If you guys have an Apple device, you click this, and it'll take you right to where you need to be to download it. If you have an Android device, you can absolutely click that one as well. Anybody have a BlackBerry?
Because what about a flip phone?
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, we'll stick.
There might be people with flip phones.
Yeah, there may be. That's okay. Oh, okay. The battery life on those is awesome. So please connect and make sure you guys get that downloaded. It's going to be really exciting for us. And then also with on top of that, tied into the website and tied into kind of what we've been discussing here as well, is just a reminder that there's a way to give online, right? In this day and age, like me, I never have cash. I always have to go to my wife. She's my ATM when I need cash for anything. I hate going to the ATM for some reason. So we made it really convenient for those of us not only in here, but also those of you watching too. You know, this is a great thing. As Pastor always says, this is not something that you have to do. This is something that you get to do. We want to make sure that we're sowing into this so we can continue to reach those of you watching and expand it as well. So it's very simple. Literally, it'll take you step by step. You choose where you want to give. You enter the amount. You can log in and create your own account here. It's very secure. I can assure you that. Don't worry about it. It's tied into PayPal. So either use your PayPal or you can create one again. Very simple. And then you can, you know, at the end of the year, you know, for tax purposes, if anybody does that, you can pull a history of your givings. You can continue to give on a frequent basis. You can set it up automatically so you don't forget. So anyway, check it out, LifePoint, lpcmentor.com.
Yes.
Download the app. It's accessible on the website, on those badges, or on your smartphones as well.
We're getting shoot off the stage now.
Oh, my gosh. All right. Cane's coming out.
I know it. Thank you for your time and attention.
Have a great service,
everybody. Let's get back.
This morning was the hardest thing to do, but packing my bags was so easy compared to standing outside my door right now to say goodbye to you.
Think of me.
I know you've never seen me cry.
Think of me.
But it's so hard to say goodbye.
Think of me.
Why can't I seem to show you I'll never give up on you? I will be waiting for you, and I will
be there when you call, and I will see you through it all. And even in your darkest hour, pray that the Lord we found will set you on solid ground.
I know that it feels like leaving is a part of letting go, but I'm praying with hope and believing that I'll see you once again. Down this road, brought you as a friend.
Think of me.
I know he'll bring you back again.
Think of me.
How can I seem to show you?
I'll never give up on you. I will be waiting for you, and I will be there when you call. And I will see you through it all. And even in your darkest hour, I pray that the Lord we found will set you on solid ground.
Think of me.
I know you've never seen me cry.
Think of
But it's so hard to say goodbye. Why can't I seem to show you?
I'll never give up on you. I will be waiting for you.
And I will be there when you call. And I will see you through it all. And even in your pray that the Lord we found. And I will be there when you call.
Oh, when you call.
And I will see you through it all. And even in your darkest hour, I pray that the Lord we found will set you on solid ground.
Ooh. Let's give it up for the brother and sister team of Caleb and Laura. Amen. Praise the Lord. How many are ready for God's word?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
I'm trying to get there.
That's not going to work. Hold on 1 minute. All right, I'm ready. Praise God. Josh said, I don't need it. Amen. How many are ready to soar to your summit? Roderick. Okay, I'm going to preach to Roderick today. Amen. Father, we thank you once again for this day. We ask you to bless the word. Give us ears to hear what your spirit is saying. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And everyone said, amen. All of us have something in our life that we can improve on. Thank you. There's something in our life that we can take to the next level. There's something in our life that we can take it up a notch. And generally at this time of the year, those are some of the things that we start thinking about. Things that we want to change in our life, things that we want to make different in our life, things that we want to improve in our life. And so maybe you have, maybe you haven't, maybe this series will get you to think in those terms, but all of us have some area in our life that we can improve on. Maybe for some of us, it's we've been just putting something off this year, and this year you're decided that I'm going to scale this mountain this year. And for some, it might be as simple as just being on time. Ouch. Better move on off of that one right there. For others, it might be just, you know what, I need to take better care of myself. I'm gonna eat better. I'm going to exercise. I'm just going to take better care of myself. For some, it might be, you know what, I really need to get my finances in order. I'm going to make sure that I get on a budget. By the way, part of our life group is going to be financial peace. I would encourage you to be a part of that group as well. Kristen and Rob are going to be taking care of that group for us. But whatever it might be a career change. You may be sitting in this room today and you're thinking, you know what? I want to change my direction. I want to change my course. I want to change my job this year. How many of you know you're never too old to start over? You're never too old. In case you're wondering, Abraham was 75 years old when God told him to move. Moses was 80 years old when God sent him back to deliver Israel. More recently, and I'm not sure these all go in the same category, but Martha Stewart was in her 40s when she changed and went national with her product. Sam Walton, anybody remember him? Anybody been to Walmart this week? Started his first store when he was 46 years old. Walmart. Colonel Sanders, anyone ever ate Kentucky Fried Chicken? Anybody want some chicken right now? 68 years old when he started his first KFC. Look at your neighbor and tell him, you're never too old to start something. You know, maybe your summit this year is a relationship. Maybe you know I need to make better choices with the people I'm with. You know, maybe I need to repair some relationship, or maybe I need to release some relationships. All of us have something in our life that we can make better. Amen? And so in this series, I'm going to try to use some different mountaintop experiences that we read in our Bible and just metaphorically use them to apply to our life as we soar to our summit. And so the first story that I want to share with you this morning is found in 1 Samuel chapter 9, and it deals with a young man who God seems to pluck out of the valley of obscurity and elevates this young man to the pinnacle of power and prominence. And so in this story, we read about the first king of Israel. Now, let's look at it together. And if you have your iPhone, you can go there. Your iPad, you can go there. If you have either one, you can have your eyelids and look up here on the screen, and they'll help you out. Well, this is what it says. That's as good as it gets, folks. There was a Benjamite, a man of standing, whose name was Kish. In other words, this was a powerful man. This was a popular man. And I'm not about to attempt to butcher his descendants. So I'm going to move right on to verse 2. Kish had a son named Saul, as handsome as a young man as could be found in anywhere in Israel. And he was a head taller than anyone else, head and shoulders taller above anyone in Israel. Now the donkeys belonging to Saul's father Kish were lost. And Kish said to his son, take one of the servants with you and go and look for the donkeys. So he passed through the hill country of Ephraim, through the area of Shalisha, but did not find them. They went on to Shalim, but the donkeys were not there. Then he passed through the territory of Benjamin, but he did not find them there. So here we have this story. We have Saul, who is to be the next king, or the first king of Israel. He is sent by his father Kish with a servant to look for lost donkeys. I guess they didn't lose keys back then. They lost donkeys. It wasn't the homework that they lost. They lost donkeys back then. And so sends them. They go out throughout the territory. They search. They come to the end of this extensive search. And the Bible lets us know that they come up empty. All right, we're going to talk about that. Here's the first point if you're going to soar to your summit. The first thing that you have to understand is this. There are no shortcuts to your summit. No shortcuts. I wish there was some type of magical formula. I wish there was some fairy dust that we could sprinkle over our summit and suddenly it would just happen for us. How many of you know I have a 3-year-old granddaughter and we've been watching Tinkerbell? The fairy dust. You guys are making me work hard today. Well, thank you. It doesn't work that way, right? We don't live a fairy tale. We live in reality. And the reality is there are no shortcuts if you're going to make it to your summit. As a matter of fact, as you and I begin to ascend, we're going to discover that there are times we're going to come up empty. There are times that we are going to fail. There are times that it's going to be hard and it's going to be difficult. There are times that we're going to face setbacks. These are all part of the process as you begin to sail or to soar to your summit. Now, here's what I want you to notice. The Bible said that as they set out on their journey, they passed through the mountains of Ephraim. Now, I want to talk about that for a moment, and I want to symbolically pull it into our lives. Ephraim was the name that was given by Joseph to his second son that was born to him in Egypt. The first one was Manasseh. So he had a son, Manasseh, and he had a son by the name of Ephraim. The name Ephraim means twice fruitful. It means fruitfulness, but it also carries with it another side. And the other side of it means ashes. It means worthless, and it means grief. And doesn't that really describe the journey that Joseph took on the way to his summit? I mean, Joseph had this God-sized dream. God gave him that dream. God put that desire in his heart. But with that dream came a tremendous amount of grief, a tremendous amount of difficulty, as he began to climb that mountain to fulfill God's purpose for his life. Listen to me. No one ever achieves their summit without climbing the mountain of Ephraim. No one will achieve greatness or success without first climbing the mountain of Ephraim. There is no way around it. You can't go around it. You have to go climb up it. And when I put the two sides of the coin together, the meaning of the name Ephraim, this is what you come up with. God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. That's what it means. God has blessed me in spite of my difficulties, in spite of my failings, in spite of the hardships. God still blesses us. You have to understand that you might be going through a difficult season, a time of hardship, a time of struggle, but you also have to understand there is a blessing in the struggle. There's a blessing that comes as you continue to persevere and endure what is before you. That's why you should never, ever look at someone and look at the fruit of their life. You should never look at them and be jealous of what God is doing in their life. You should never, ever envy someone else's blessing. Yeah, it's good to look at. Yeah, it's good to say, you know what? I wish I had that. But you have to understand there's a flip side of the coin of their blessing. There's a flip side of the blessing in their life. All you see is the fruit of it. You don't see the afflicted part of it. You don't see that part of it. A lot of times that part is hidden because those are parts we typically don't like to share with people. We typically don't like to share those difficulties, those hardships, those trials because we want people to see our success. But how many of you know you're never going to get to that mountain without affliction? You're never going to achieve that goal without perseverance. There will be difficulty and there will be struggle. I find it interesting when Joseph took the two boys, Manasseh and Ephraim, to Jacob to be blessed. Jacob was, the Bible said, was sick and he was getting ready to pass and his eyes had grown dim. And Joseph takes the two boys, and in the Bible days, they would bring their children, and they would pronounce blessings over them. How many of you know that's probably something we still should be doing, speaking blessings and life over our children and not cursing them. And so he brings the two boys to Jacob, their grandfather, and he positions them where Manasseh would receive from the right hand of Jacob, and Ephraim from the left hand of Jacob. And Jacob does something that surprises Joseph. When he goes to pray for the boys, he crosses his hands. In other words, his left hand goes towards the eldest, Manasseh, and his right hand, the hand of favor and blessing, goes towards Ephraim. And Joseph stops him and says, Dad, you're making a mistake here. Manasseh is on the right side. Ephraim is on your left side. And Jacob said, I know exactly what I'm doing. And sometimes in our life, God chooses to bless the thing that we didn't expect him to bless. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Sometimes in our life, we think God is going to bless this when God switches it up and blesses that. That's why you need to be flexible, and that's why you need to understand that his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. Because there are people under the sound of my voice in this room today and watching us online that you thought this was your life's work. You thought this is what God was going to bless. And all of a sudden you found yourself terminated, or maybe you launched out and started a business and it failed. Maybe, just maybe, God was about to switch some things up on you. And what you thought he was going to bless, he didn't bless. And what you thought he would not bless, he blesses. I just stopped by to tell somebody in this room, on your way up, expect God to cross some things up in your life, and don't be surprised every now and then that God blesses something you didn't think he was ever going to bless. Not because we're good, not because we deserve it, but because of his amazing grace. Come on, if you believe it, put your hands together and give him praise. We're talking about scaling mountains here. Let me ask someone a question. On the count of three, I want you to shout it out for me. Name, shout out a famous mountain. Stop. And the prize goes to Brandon. Gander Mountain is blessed. Well, some of you said Mount Everest, so let's talk about it. Highest peak on the planet, 29,035 feet. So, if your dream is to climb Mount Everest, how would you do it? How would you climb it? It's kind of a rhetorical question. It's kind of a setup question. But let me just give you the answer. If you were going to climb, you would start at the bottom. I'm not being smart, just going somewhere. You would start at the bottom, and you would take one step at a time. If you want to get to the top, you got to start at the bottom. Starting at the bottom, though, is really not fun. But in order to get to your summit, you have to start at the bottom. Isn't it funny how we look at people and it took them 20 years to achieve and to get what they have, and we want it instantly? I mean, sometimes you may look and even at your parents and you may think, well, man, I want what they had. Well, do you want to do what they did to get there? I mean, if you look at somebody's life and you see the blessing on their life, it didn't happen overnight. They didn't start up here. They started here, and one step along the way, another step, 1 month, 2 months, 12 months, 24 months, 20 years to get to that peak. You didn't see them at their base. You saw them at their peak. But you have to understand, every single one of us start at a base. And let's face it, starting at the bottom is mundane. And a lot of times it's miserable because you have to struggle just to survive. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Just to survive, you're struggling. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. And sometimes at the base, at the bottom, it feels worthless. It's like, what meaning does this have? This is useless. But you need to be careful that at every phase and every level in your life, you need to be careful to make sure that you apply yourself to that. Make sure that you give it all that you have, because whatever you do not value, you will neglect. And you have to be careful because sometimes we are neglecting something that God has placed in our life that's going to get us to the summit that He has chosen for us. Never look at anything as insignificant or unimportant. I'm telling you right now, God will use all of it on your journey. God will use every part, every piece, every person, good or bad, as part of the journey collectively to get you where He's desired and designed for you to be. I want you to look at this scripture in Colossians chapter 3. It says this. I'm about to cuss, but watch me. Work hard. Work hard. It means it's not going to be handed to you. And I'm not saying we can't bless people and we shouldn't bless people, but listen to what the Bible says. Work hard and cheerfully at some of the things you do. Work hard and cheerfully at all you do, just as though you were working for the Lord and not merely for your master. Well, my boss, then you bypass your boss, keep a good attitude, and understand that you have a higher boss than that boss. Understand that you're doing this unto and for the Lord. Work hard and have a good attitude in the process. This needs to be our MO. This needs to be our mindset. Why? Because there are no shortcuts to your summit. Work hard. Study hard. Serve with an excellent spirit. If you find yourself saying, oh, this is good enough, then you need to take it up another notch. Especially in the kingdom of God. We represent God and we represent His kingdom. And so whatever we do, just like Daniel, we do it with a spirit of excellence. And if the best we have is this right here, right now, then we make it the best possible. We serve with excellence. We minister with excellence. We do whatever we do with the spirit of excellence. That's what will get you noticed. Not a bad attitude, not a complaining spirit, not a griping spirit, not a get around the water cooler and talk about those over you spirit, but a spirit that separates yourself from those things and says, this is unto the Lord, and I'm going to give everything I have for it. I'm telling you, if you'll have that kind of mindset, the sky is the limit for you. Never look at something as worthless, useless. Everything you do is unto the Lord. If you want to stand on your summit, then you have to be good at the bottom. If you want to stand on the summit, you have to make sure that you're good and faithful and determined on the bottom. Divinity is in the details, and do small things well. Do them well. Jesus talked about the power of being faithful with small things. Listen to me. He said, when you're faithful with this, I'll bless you with that. And some of us want that when we've not been faithful with this. And you're never going to get that until you're faithful with this. But the minute you become faithful with this, then God says you're ready for that. Did I confuse anybody? Good. And so be faithful with where you are and what you're doing, and God will bring increase in your life. So maybe the floorboard in my car does matter. Someone said, I want a new car. I'd say, go clean your floorboard out. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Y'all looking at me like a deer with headlights. Your car is your... I can't believe that preacher's preaching to me about my car. It's not a trash can. Excellence. Excellence. Some of your convictions coming on you right now. You're like, good Lord, I hope I never have to give him a ride. Small things matter. Maybe starting on time is important. Maybe going the extra mile means something. It matters. Look at your neighbor and tell them it matters. Hey, think about it this way, church. Think about it this way. We're looking at Saul. There is about to be a monumental political shift in the history of Israel. They're moving from judges and tribal leaders to a centralized form of government where Saul is going to be king over Israel. And the first biblical bio of the first king of Israel, what do we read him doing? Is he out killing Philistines? Is he out defeating armies? Is he with the judges and the tribal leaders strategically planning what they're going to do? The first king of Israel who's being prepped by God to be a king is on donkey duty. Donkey duty. Woo. And guess what? He's not even good at it. Because he hasn't found them. They can't find the donkeys. But you know what he's not doing? Notice in the story. Keep reading. You'll notice he's not complaining. He's not saying, you know what? This is below me. Don't you think about it for a moment. Remember the scripture we read that his father was basically a powerful man. The fact that the Bible says take one of the servants lets us know that, plural, they had multiple servants, and if you had a servant, you had a little bit of money. And my question might have been, you know what? Why not send two servants and just let me stay here at the house? He said, you and find another servant and go out and start looking for the donkeys. He didn't think it was below him. And we're going to find out that he didn't quit either. The course changes. And this is important. I'm not going to get into all of this today. This is why this series is going to be important for us. Because the course changes. Because he gets to the point where they're no longer looking for the donkeys. And God's destiny is about to be revealed to him. It's in the mundane things of life that you find and discover the destiny and the purpose that God has for you. But here's what I want you to understand. He wasn't complaining. He didn't feel like it was below him. And he didn't quit. Look at your neighbor and tell him, don't quit. Do not quit. Do you realize in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, a time and season for all things? Right? The Bible says there's list 28 seasons in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Do you realize not one mention of a season of quitting? Not one. There's never a season to quit. There are times to regroup, yes. There are times to be refreshed, yes. But there's never, ever a season of quitting. Do not allow that to become part of your MO. Stick it out. Tough it out. Let God bring you through the process. And I'm telling you, at the end of the day, you will be better served for it. Master the mundane. Do the small things great. Keep believing that God is going to turn your opposition to an opportunity. How many of you believe that today? Master the mundane. I mentioned this is a hard season because there's a real struggle, and the struggle is to survive. Anytime you start at the base, there's always a struggle. It's always hard. It's difficult. If you were going to climb, and we're going to talk more about this in the weeks coming up, if you were going to climb Mount Everest, it takes you 2 months just to prepare for it. You will go in March, and you'll prepare for 2 months because there's a season to climb. All that'll preach right there. And they'll start climbing in May. But it takes 2 months just to get acclimated to the climate. It takes 2 months to embrace yourself or to get acclimated to, what's the elevation? For your body to adjust. Listen to this. The base of the mountain is at 17,700 feet. That's the base. Do you realize just to get to the base, you have to walk. It takes 7 days to get to the base of the mountain. 17, almost 18,000 feet. There are little, what they call tea huts, and they ain't all that. It's just places where you stop along the way. And then once you get to the base of that mountain, what happens is you'll climb to a certain level, you'll stop, and then they send you back down. You'll rest, you'll climb, you'll go to another level, they'll send you back down. In other words, once you don't just start going to the top at the beginning. You climb, you level off, you come back down. You climb, you level off, you come back down. You climb, you level off, you come back down. Isn't that life? You climb, you level off, you come back down. You climb, you level off, you come back down. But eventually, if you keep climbing, you'll get to the peak. If you keep climbing, you'll get to the top. You'll get there. But there is a real struggle. There's a struggle at the bottom. There's a struggle in the process. There's a struggle to get there. Look at this scripture. I got to hurry. Saul said to his servant, if we go. Now, this is where things are shifting, and I'll talk about this part next week. But I just want to focus on this. I want you to see something. The food in our sacks is gone. Been on this journey. We've been looking for these donkeys, and in the process, we've ran out of supplies. Some of you, that's where you're at. You know what it's like to have all this time and all of this energy invested and still be broke. Hello? At least wave at me. You know what it's like to have all this investment, all this time, and still be struggling to make ends meet. You haven't got your breakthrough yet, but it's coming. Look at your neighbor and tell them, it's coming. It's coming. The struggle, the survival, is all part of the process. How many of you know that sometimes we hurt people when we try to help people in certain things? Are you with me? Sometimes we need to let them struggle. It's painful to step back and watch them, but during that time of struggling, they're building endurance. They're building and developing character. They're understanding that you are not their source, but God is their source. God can use you as a resource, but God is their source. God is their source. Have to be careful, because sometimes when we think we're helping somebody, we are ultimately hurting them. Sometimes you just got to let them go in order to grow. Let them go and watch them grow. God's not going to let you starve. Do you really think God's going to let you starve to death? Do you really think that God's not going to provide a place for you? Come on, church, you know better than that. Do you really think the struggle's going to last forever? That's the lie of the enemy, to try to get us to think this thing's going to last forever, and nothing does. Remember, there were two places, Ephraim. The other place was Shalisha. I think I said it right. That word Shalisha means three. It means threefold, or the third time. What was the day Jesus got up? On the third day. So when they went on the first day, everything was the same. They went on the second day, everything was the same. But when they went back on the third day, things changed. And I was trying to get someone to see that maybe spiritually you're getting ready to enter into your third day, And that simply means some things are about to change and there's some resurrection about to happen in your life. God's about to resurrect some things in your life. I found it interesting that this name, this place that they went to, not only does it mean three, but there's only one other place in the Bible that references this place. It's found in 2 Kings chapter 4, or chapter 4, that's right. And I just want to show you something I want to parallel in here. It says, one day, a man from Baal, which means Lord, Salisha, brought Elisha a sack of fresh corn and 20 individual loaves of barley bread. And he told Gehazi to use it to feed the prophets. What does that mean to you and I? What is that saying to us, prophetically, symbolically? What does that mean? This is what it means. It means that during your time of struggle, they were in a famine during this time. During your time of trouble, God has already laid it on someone's heart to bless you. God has already made a means for provision in your life. Listen, this guy just showed up. And there was no relationship, there was no correlation, he just showed up. How many of you know there are many different ways God can bring blessings into your life? Many, many different ways. I'm talking about getting through your season of struggle right now. God has already placed it on someone's heart. You don't even know it right now. Somebody right now, maybe they don't show up and hand you a $20 bill or whatever, but maybe they're on their knees right now praying you through what you're going through. Maybe they're the one God is laying you upon their heart and they're interceding for you and they're going to help you get your breakthrough. But I can guarantee you one thing. Your struggle is not alone. And God has somebody in your life that he's going to use to bless you. The second principle to this is the bread was given to feed the prophets. There were 100 prophets, 20 pieces of bread. You do the math. What does that mean to us? It simply means this. In your season of struggle, make sure that you feed your prophet. Pastor, what in the world does that mean? What does a prophet do? A prophet prophesies. He foretells about future things. This is what's coming. This is what's going to happen. This is what you need to do. So in your season of struggle, make sure that you're not feeding your struggle, but feed your future. In other words, I may be making minimum wage right now, but I'm going to prophesy to my future because God has a future for me and God's going to bring a blessing into my life and I'm going to prophesy until I see that come to pass. Feed your prophet. Prophesy about your future. Listen, you can change a season by what comes out of your mouth. Simply open your mouth and change your season. Someone said, what are you talking about? I'm telling you, blessing and curses come out of your mouth. What are you blessing and what are you cursing? Prophesy to your future and watch and see what God will do. Feed your future. Feed it. Starve your past and feed your future. How many of you believe that better days are ahead? I want you to stand to your feet then. Come on, stand to your feet. The number 20 also represents, as we're just waiting to close out here, the number 20 represents in the Bible a perfect waiting season. Perfect waiting season. Do you realize that Jacob waited 20 years to marry Rachel? He waited 20 years to be free from the control of Laban. The children of Israel waited 20 years to be freed from Jabin, king of the Canaanites, who oppressed them. 20 years. Perfect waiting period. The Hebrew letter, and I know I'm going a little bit deep here, but stay with me. The Hebrew letter that represents the number 20 means this. It means an open hand. An open hand. It signifies, are you ready for this? Giving freely. Some of you have been waiting patiently. You've been in a season of struggle, but you didn't quit. You just kept going and you kept doing. And nobody but you knew the struggle you were going through. And you were able to fake it. And people thought you had it all together. People thought, man, I'd like to be them. But on the inside, the struggle, the pain of you struggling and you striving to reach that summit, trying to just get from the base, just to get up another notch, to get up another level. And because you've been faithful in the little, God's hand is now being extended to bless you. I felt this strong. I felt it strong as I was preparing this week and this message. God's palm is open towards you. In other words, God says, my blessing is in my hand. And I'm reaching out to you right now. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. This is the year for some people in this room and those of you watching us online. This is the year for some of you. You've been waiting and waiting and waiting and doing everything you know to do. God's hand is open and promotion is about to happen in this new season of your life. If you believe that, just lift up those hands and just give God a great big thank you, Jesus. Come on, would you do that right now? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I'm going to be faithful right where I'm at, right what I'm doing, but I know this is not it. I know it's not it. I know there's so much more. I know the dream that you put in my heart. I know the vision that you've given me. And Lord, even though it may appear as though time is running out, it's not running out. Perfect timing is about to take place. Jesus. Jesus. I just feel like this is the altar call, and I know we're getting out of time here, but listen to me. I feel like symbolically God's about to lay his hand of blessing on you right now. Promotion. I feel like telling somebody right now the struggle is over. You're about to soar. If that's you and you feel like, I'm ready for God to lay his hand of blessing upon me. I'm ready to move to the next phase and the next base part of this climb. If that's you, I want you to just get out of your seat and meet us down here quickly. Come on. I'm ready for the blessing of God to manifest in my life. I'm ready. This struggle, I'm ready for this season of struggle. I'm ready for it. I'm ready for it to change. I'm ready for it to change. Come on. I just want to make sure you understand the invitation. God's hand is open. God's hand is open. And he's saying, I'm ready to bless you. I'm ready to bless you. Come on. Just want to make sure you understand what I'm saying. I'm ready. My hand is open. And I'm ready to release what's in it. I'm ready to release it to you right now. I'm ready to release it. We're going to pray. But if you're ready, I want you to make your way here. I'm ready. I'm ready. Are you ready? You ready? Let's worship. Let's worship. Let's pray for those who need prayer. I'm ready for God's blessing. I'm ready for God's blessing. Lord, lay your hand on me now. Your open hand, Father. And release what you have for me, Lord.
I worship you.
Release what you have for me, Father.
I worship you.
Release it now, Lord.
You are here. Working in
we
this
speak
place.
To we speak
I
to it
worship
now,
you.
We speak to it now, Lord.
I worship
let the
you.
Season change, Father. Let it change. Provision.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. He's a waymaker. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
He's a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Miracle worker, way maker, 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 miracle.
Even when I can't see it,
even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.